Namaskaram. Hello and welcome to P Guru's channel. I'm your host, Sri Iyer. Today, I have with me Lieutenant General Ravi Shankar, and we are going to talk about a topic that we have not touched upon before. And as always, the erudite general is going to share with us a few PowerPoint slides, and let's see what he has to say about our neighbor, Myanmar. General Ravi Shankar, Namaskar, and welcome to P Guru's channel.
Namaskaram, and thanks for calling me again, Mr. Iyer. It's a pleasure to be here and give my thoughts on various issues. Yeah, Myanmar, as you said, is a very, critical neighbor of ours. As we had discussed in the last, where we left off on Pakistan, we have Pakistan unstable and so is Myanmar, and both our wings are on fire. So we'll go whichever way you want.
Yes. So let's get started, sir. I know you have a presentation to share with our viewers. Perhaps you can start with that and then we can see the questions that will lead up to it. Okay. How far back does the presentation go, sir? Does it go back to the time when Myanmar or they then Burma expelled all Indian expats?
Yeah. We'll go back in time. Bring it from the British times. Right?
Yeah. Many people don't realize that people came back with their clothes and they had to walk it back from Rangoon all the way to Chennai and beyond.
Yeah. We had a lot of connect. A lot of people in Chennai had a lot of connect with Rangoon.
Yes.
Burma teak. In fact, the Burma teak trade used to come from Rangoon to Chennai and then go up north to. That's the thing. Right. Let me share my PowerPoint with you.
Sure.
Yeah. Can you see this?
Yeah.
Right.
Very nice. Yeah.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, today I'll take you through a journey into Myanmar. It's a troubled state today. There's a flag and all that. But it's a very interesting quote I got, It says, the problem with Myanmar is that it is ruled by a queen and a king, but they're not married to each other. If I add to it, they're on the verge of a divorce before marriage, right? And that's how you describe Myanmar best today. Okay, let me take you back and, give you an overview about what Myanmar is and everything. If you look at the map of Asia, you'll see that Myanmar is central and pivotal to any aspect of the Indo-Pacific strategy. I mean, one has to understand its centrality in this Indo-Pacific concept and construct. It is then we realize where we are as far as this whole story is concerned. There's the Indo part and the Pacific part, and Myanmar sits at the pivotal and central part. Myanmar stretches far down south. This is the extent of Myanmar. It has a huge connect to the Bay of Bengal, and it also has a connect with the Pacific. Right? And just to put it in a little more perspective, this is the place, this is called the Kra Isthmus, and this is where the Chinese are negotiating with Thailand and Malaysia to put across the Kra Canal and the Kra Isthmus land route so that they can get over the Malacca dilemma. Right. Now, Myanmar has long borders with a lot of countries. If you look at it, it has a border of about 256 kilometers with Bangladesh right here. In this Rakhine state, that's a place where the Rohingyas used to stay. It has a border of about 1,300 kilometers with India. And it touches four states, Mizoram, Manipur, Nagaland, and Arunachal Pradesh. Very important, right? And then it has about 2,000 odd kilometers with border with China all the way down here. It's got a short border of about 200 odd kilometers with Laos and a long border of another 2,000 kilometers with Thailand. It's got a long distance. And most importantly, it has got a huge coastline of over 2,000 kilometers with in the Bay of Bengal and the Andaman Sea, right? Now, if you look at the area of Myanmar, it's over 677,000 kilometers. East to west, it's about 900 kilometers. North to south is over 2,000 kilometers. It's a big country. It's not a small country, right? And to the north, east, that is abutting India and the west, sorry, China and west abutting India, there are hills and valleys. And these hills and valleys are the foothills of Himalayas. Himalayas turns around and comes down in the north-south fashion. And through the valleys of these mountains flow the rivers of Chindwin and Irrawaddy. If you see in this map, you get Chindwin and Irrawaddy, Sitong and Salween. And the agricultural land and population is all in the valleys. And that's where the major populations are. Okay. When you look at the ethnic composition, the Burmans, that's how the name comes, Burma, are maximum 55%. And of course, you have a whole lot of other ethnicities. It's a very multi-ethnic country and area, just like our Northeast is. A lot of people are mixed with each other. And it has its states are based largely on ethnicities. Religion, Buddhism is the most popular, I wouldn't say popular one, prevalent one. Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, and others are all there. And it is made up of about 135 national races. It's got major ethnic groups, like I said, 135. But the major groups are what I have shown, right? And this is how they are spread out, you'll see. The Burmans, the major group, are in the center. They are the ones who populate the valleys and the rivers and the agriculture. And the other tribes are all generally hill tribes, right? And they have not had a great relationship with each other. If you see, there is some similarity between India and Indian tribes and their tribes. If you look at Manipur, Manipur Valley is all the Metis, right? And agriculture who live in valleys. Whereas the surrounding areas of Manipur are all Nagas and Mars and, you know, Chins and all that. They're hill tribes. Almost same, similar problems, but bigger and a weaker state. When you look at the economy, it's very interesting. It's got an economy of about, there's a, all about 2,000 figures of 55 billion GDP, per capita of $876. And this, if you see sectorially, agriculture is the max. Services, industry has got about 20, but with a lot of scope to grow. And that's because, we'll come to that. The people, we have about 61 million population, quite a big, a lot of population. And like I said, and a young population and young country. Okay, resources. It's got tremendous resources, natural gas, oil reserves, right? Water. Water is a major resource of Myanmar. And with the great hydropower potential and huge forest cover, and 90% of the world's rubies come from here. And also, this is the part of the Golden Crescent or the Golden Triangle for the drug trafficking. Not the Golden Crescent. The Golden Crescent is in the west, Afghanistan, Thailand, Laos, this Cambodia, southern China. Myanmar, all these form the Golden Triangle in parts. So there's a lot of drug trafficking on here. And so this is what the resources are, a country full of resources. When you look at social indicators, not great. Their literacy is great, but 25% poverty level, right? 64 years life expectancy, 41%, 41 per 1,000 infant mortality. Not great medical facilities, but a lot of access to safe water because there's a lot of water there.
Right.
And 77% access to sanitation facilities. By nature, the Myanmaris are generally clean and neat, and you know they've got great habits. And this is what I got to know from my colleagues who've been to Myanmar. Okay, in terms of trades, exports and imports, approximately the same. About 10 to 12%, 12 billion. The top three exports are natural gas and petroleum, wood and legumes. Now, wood is something which is some important. All the teak comes from there. In the days of the year, we had a great trade with Burma for the Burma treat, which used to come into India. It used to come from Rangoon to Chennai and Andaman Nicobar or Calcutta and get into the rest of the country. These were the 2, 3, 4 centers where Burma teak used to think. So as a result, you'll find a lot of Bengalis and Tamilians have populated Andaman Nicobar as a result, and also were had populated Rangoon. The trade was revolving around these two ethnicities, Tamilians and Bengalis. And the top three imports are vehicles, iron and steel, and all other things. And the trading partners, of course, are China, Taiwan, Thailand and Japan. Now, let's go into the timeline. It's got a troubled past, and its future is also going to be troubling. And there are no easy solutions to whatever Myanmar is going through. But notwithstanding that, we'll go through. It was in the last century, in fact, the 19th century, that Britain captured Mandalay, and it became a British, part of the British India, right? Somewhere in last century, 1937, Britain separated Burma from India and made it a crown colony, separate. It was not part of the, India. It was in 1942 that Japan invaded India, invaded and occupied Burma as part of the Japanese campaign. It was 1945, 3 years, the Slims defeat into victory in the Burma campaign culminated in the Japanese leaving Burma. And that was when Aung San, he was the leader of the Burmese or the Myanmarese, that is Aung San Suu Kyi's father. He was the leader who was part of the liberation struggle for Burma. And then 1948, Burma became independent, and U Thant, who knew, was the prime minister. But later, if you remember, in the 60s, they had a UN secretary general called U Thant.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. And 62, he was ousted in a coup. And then from 62 onwards, there have been a series of coups and, disasters. 87, this continued. It remained an isolated country. 87, there was a currency valuation and everything. There was economic disaster. And in between this, around between 48 and 62, there was a mass eviction of Indians from Burma. A lot of them came back, which we had discussed at the outset. That is when a lot of Indians repatriated. A lot of Indians repatriated to Manipur. If you go to the border state of border city called Moray in Manipur, it is dominated by Tamilians of that thing. And if you go there and speak Tamil, they feel very happy, even now, right? And it's been through strife, 1988, 1999, martial law problems, the SLORC, the Strait Law and Order Restoration Council, as it is today called, came into being in 1998. Then 1990, the NLD came up. It won a landslide victory in some election, but the military sidelined it, never gave it power. Okay, that is the time when Aung San Suu Kyi was awarded the Nobel Prize for standing up to SLORC. Then in 1992, there was a change of power. Tan Shwe came in and he became the prime minister, defense minister and everything. And he released Aung San Suu Kyi from house arrest after 6 years. And 1997, Burma was admitted to the ASEAN. It's very interesting to know that Burma or Myanmar, whichever you call it, is the only ASEAN country with which India has a border. Right? That's what makes Burma important. One of the points, but there are more. And it was in 2005, the Tatmadaw, or the Tatmadaw is the army, the Myanmarese army as it's called. They moved the capital to Naypyitaw. And then 2007, in between, they arrested and put Aung San Suu Kyi back into house arrest. It was extended. In 2008, there was this cyclone Nargis, if you remember. It devastated Myanmar. No one could go in and help people also. And they went through a very bad this thing. they had deaths as high as 1,34,000. I mean, can you imagine? Today, we in the days of the virus and the pandemic, India has just had about 1,80,000 deaths, maybe 2 lakhs. That's a minor issue. It's an issue, but over a year, through a global pandemic, we've had only about 1,80,000 to 2 lakh deaths. Whereas in one cyclone, in over a period of 2 days or 3 days, this was the official count. We don't know how many more died. It was bad, right? And of course, Aung San Suu Kyi was arrested for breaking house arrest conditions. It was a troubled time. If you see the whole thing, disasters, economic collapses, and you know, arrests and what have you, right? But when you look at the period 2011 to 12 is a little interesting. I wouldn't say interesting, was a time of stabilization. That was a time when Thein Sein was sworn in as the president. And then he met Aung San Suu Kyi and they came to some understanding. And very interestingly, in August, September 2011, he suspended the dam called Mitsune Hydroelectric Dam, which we'll talk about a little later, which the Chinese were constructing. And because at the outset, I must say, Chinese are not very welcome in Myanmar as a whole. Okay. He also freed political prisoners. Then he put up the elections when Aung San Suu Kyi said she'll stand for elections. Hillary Clinton visited Myanmar, met her. She also held talks with Thein Sein. Dr. Manmohan Singh, he paid his first visit since 1987. Not his first visit, as Indian Prime Minister's first visit. It happened in May 2012. It was quite a landmark achievement because we were almost restarting our equations with Myanmar. Though it had started a little before, but things, this thing. And US President offered Barack Obama, he offered to help Myanmar and, you know, come back. And this is a time when Myanmar was seen to be coming out of its isolation and away from the Chinese shadow and things like that. And if you come back to 2015, Aung San Suu Kyi, she formed the government. In 2017, we had the Rohingya crisis. And it was seen that she didn't do much. The whole world said, look, this is a crisis where she could have done quite a bit, and she didn't. And she was seen to be pandering to the Chinese more and all that. And then this February, we had the elections again. The governing NLD bet pro-military candidates hands down. That was in November. And the army alleged the fraud. The army chief took over in February, 1st of February, he staged the coup. And he said that he's taking over for 1 year, but that is to be seen. And he's put Aung San Suu Kyi and all her supporters under house arrest. And of course, this is a photograph of the times when they had a good time. I mean, they were on better wickets and they were shaking hands. Now, like I said, the king and the queen are not married and they're on the verge of a divorce. Right. Now, when you assess the overall situation in Myanmar, let's look at it from people, the army, and various angles to it. When you look at the people, more than 600 civilians, including children, are dead in this entire crisis. More than 3,000 people have been detained, and most of them are NLD people or the democratic forces. The people are against the army or the Tatmadaw. The people are also against China, and a lot of Chinese owned garment factories have been torched because that was a developing trade. And they have tasted democracy, and democracy is like toothpaste. Once it comes out, it will not go in. So now they are very firmly against the army. And the ethnic rebels in the north have jumped in. Now, as far as the army is concerned, they have the gun. And a lot of reports suggest that they have taken Chinese help. They, as far as India is concerned, they have a balance equation. And we've developed this equation over the past decade or so. But then the army is not popular with the people. They'll remain in the power structure. We should not be under anything that total democracy will be restored. They're wary of China due to support of ethnic minority rebels. I mean, you have to understand that the northern part of China, Myanmar, abuts China, and there China has a history of supporting communists. And Myanmarese and the Myanmar army had to go against them. Even now, it is rumored, and we don't know, there are reports that the army, the Myanmarese army, the Tatmadaw, has used air force against these rebels. So it's a confused situation, whether the rebels are being sponsored by China or not, whether they are against the army. Is China supporting the army in its actions? Hazy. But one point, it is the Myanmarese army which has held the country together for long, right from beginning. You know, you might like it, not like it, but that's a fact. Where does NLD and the Aung San Suu Kyi stand? Now, it's very nice to say that they're part of democracy, but they're the ones who perpetuated the Rohingya crisis. I wouldn't say they perpetuated, they let it conflagrate and they didn't do much about it. But they have the popular mandate. And democracy and human rights, they've used to gain power more than using the values. And they formed a unity government and they want to form a unity government. They want to remain in power. So all the ideals for which Aung San Suu Kyi stood when she was given the Nobel Prize are gone. So it is not a great democracy and this thing. It's only a power faction as of today. The loosely controlled jungle regions to the north, we'll see it in the map again. It's a sanctuary for rebels. It's got ethnic minority groups, a lot of them. There are a lot of drug trafficking, which I said. There is a history of China backing communists and rebels, which I had earlier mentioned. And the Mitsone Dam is not popular with the people for many reasons. We'll touch upon it when I talk about China with a map so that you understand where the Mitsone Dam is. Otherwise, it's just the name. Okay. Now, what's the hard reality of Myanmar? The Tatmadaw is not the problem, but it is part of every solution. On the other hand, Aung San Suu Kyi or democracy is not the solution. It is part of the problem. So there has to be a balance which has to, you know, be brought between the two. Now, if the Tatmadaw is seriously weakened or it splits, Myanmar could descend into chaos like Iraq, Syria, and Libya. And that is what the UN Deputy General Secretary had mentioned, that it is going the Syria way. Restoration of democracy, the way we accept it, is a pipe dream. If in my analysis and many analysis, stabilization is the key. How do you stabilize it and get reconciliation? Now, the Tatmadaw is a highly privileged state within the state, something like the Pakistani army. In any situation in the Pakistani army, I mean in Pakistan, the army is part of the problem and the solution. Same thing here. It's a state within the state. You can't wish it away. Now, this lady also bears responsibility for the current situation. It's not that she isn't there. She's part of the problem, which I mentioned earlier. And both Tatmadaw and Myanmar deeply distrust China. Right? But Aung San Suu Kyi is disposed towards China. So there is everything, it's a shifting mosaic. Now, as far as the West is concerned, it looks to, you know, intends to look good, feel good, and rather than do good. And it's put some sanctions. Sanctions won't work beyond a point. Right? Then what sanctions will work against an isolated country, which is coming out of isolation? You put sanctions, it will go back into isolation. Now, China is coldly pragmatic. It will do anything to protect its interests and gain strategic advantage. That is the nature of China. It doesn't matter what's the color of the cat as far as it catches the mice. Now, Indo-Pacific partners should weigh their approaches and see what should be the line taken. And they should take a line which doesn't give China the advantage, because that's on the cards. as the thing goes. Though today it is, everything is confused, but as situation opens up and stabilizes, it's well possible that the moralistic stance of the West might give the advantage to China. And then your Indo-Pacific strategy is at risk, which I showed you. The criticality and the centrality of Myanmar is very important. Okay. A refugee crisis is on the cards and is building up. And we are affected by it. Thailand is affected by it. Laos to a small extent. China to a large extent, but China has closed its borders. Why China has closed its borders? Not because it's any altruism. It is because of COVID. COVID is rampant in Myanmar. If the refugees go into China, they'll get COVID. So they've closed the borders. And that's an opportunity. I mean, it's a bad way of putting it, but that's how it is. In hard, real politics, it's an opportunity that China will, by not letting refugees and closing that border and not giving any help, is only antagonizing the people. So the people are moving away, will move away from China as days go by. And finally, the hard reality is there are no easy solutions there. It's going to be a long drawn out crisis. Right. Numerous countries have condemned the takeover. But then when there was an Army Day parade, the Russian defense minister attended very significantly. India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Thailand, Laos, and Vietnam sent military attaches. The rest boycotted. So these countries which surround Myanmar have thrown their hat in the ring, and they don't want to break relations with the army. Right, the West has responded with sanctions on the military council, and they want to support democracy, but let's see where it goes. The ASEAN is ambivalent. Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Brunei, they all want to discuss the whole crisis and get to a resolution. They want immediate release of Aung San Suu Kyi and restoration of democracy. Now, Cambodia, Thailand, Philippines, and Vietnam, they have said it's an internal affair. So even in ASEAN, there is a slight double tone. Laos says, wait and watch. Laos will go the Chinese way because they're almost a Chinese surrogate. Now, Russia has thrown its hat into the ring in a main way. They are the main supporter of the military. They've called it a purely domestic affair of the sovereign state. And they want to increase cooperation with Myanmar. They are seizing an opportunity to situate themselves in the middle of the Indo-Pacific. The Myanmar-Russia ties have been cordial. Why is Russia doing all this? They want to enter the Indo-Pacific. They have no love lost with Myanmar. They see an opportunity that the Chinese are not going to be very welcome there. Indians are ambivalent. So they have a good equation with the army. They know that the army will be a part of the solution anyway. So let's get in there. And then that they'll clear the pitch for the Quad and the Indo-Pacific. The whole thing is pretty clear. Right. Let's look at China. What is China's interest in this whole story? And what is their stand and what are the stakes? They blocked the UN Security Council statement, which condemned the coup. No, they've described it as an internal matter. And they've also said that an international community should stop aggravating conflicts or complicating the situation. And they're largely perceived by everyone as supporting Tatmadaw, who doesn't trust them. What is the Chinese core interest in all this? They want to reach Bay of Bengal at any cost through the China-Myanmar economic corridor to get out of the Malacca dilemma. Getting out of the Malacca dilemma supports the two-ocean theory of China. So let us look at it a little more detail. Now, this is the China economic Myanmar corridor. They want a gas pipeline and an oil pipeline. And it comes from, this Kunming and this belt right through. This is called the old Lido Road till Mandalay. From Mandalay, one road goes towards Imphal. And it goes down to a port called Kaikafu. Right. Now, this is the China Myanmar economic corridor, which is the equivalent, or the Myanmar is equivalent of the CPEC. And Xi Jinping has visited Myanmar And you know, this is the Mitsonit Dam I was talking, which is in the north, right? And this has got a lot of ecological problems and all that. And the whole idea is that they want to make a mega dam here and draw power into China. Okay, and this is a remote area. So that is why the resistance. One, their ecology will go for a toss, and that power they can't use. China is soft selling it, saying, look, we'll give you money and it'll be an export and all that. But we know how China behaves, right? They are also looking at high-speed rail and economic cooperation zone on the border and a deep sea port here. Okay. But at this time, none of these have taken off. They're all in slowdown and reduced scale mode. And like I said, the Myanmaris are not prepared to put all their eggs in the Chinese basket. And beyond a point, they'll not go towards China. So, fine. But you look at it. The moment this Kaikapu port comes and the CMEC comes through, China has got an entry into the Andaman Nicobar. North Bay of Bengal. And they've beaten the Malacca corridor and Malacca dilemma.
Streets,
and this
yeah.
is just about, yeah, this is just about 400 kilometers. Right? And then it's a shortcut. And they're sitting on top of Andaman Nicobar. And you know, and if they pressurize Bangladesh, this is Bangladesh after all, and put up something in Chittagong or somewhere in Dhaka, then you get a port, even a small port, if they develop into a larger port, they have a naval presence here. So this is a dangerous situation as far as India is concerned. And we need to offset it. Now, what about India? India has got historical connect with Myanmar. You read this book called Road Past Mandalay. It gives you a fantastic idea about the growth of Indian Army in those days, right? It's a tremendous book, which I used to read when I was a second lieutenant. And this book, Defeat into Victory by Slim, is a Bible for jungle warfare, right? And it is a while many people talk of the Western Front, how the Allies bet the Germans and the Normandy landings and all that, right? This, the Britishers themselves say that the Burma campaign and the victory of Slim's army over the Japanese is a greater campaign. And the Indian Army was the bulk of this campaign. Actually, it's our history. If you look at it, many of our training institutions have companies called Kohima, Imphal, Mandalay, all these. These are all bought from this Nowshera. Nowshera, of course, is there, that side, right? So we have a huge connect with Myanmar militarily. The Indian Army has learned its lessons and training from that. We get the lineage from there. Like I said, you look at this Mektila, Mandalay, Arakan campaign, Sitwa, Chinditz, the Battle of the Admin Box, right? And this is the time, interestingly, the nationalist China and Britain were on the same side. Like I said, I spoke to you about the old Lido Road. And the Japanese came up to Mandalay. The Chinese withdrew towards Kunming and the British Indian Army moved towards Manipur. And the Japanese came up to Kohima and Imphal line. And from there, they were rolled back. So these are all, right, like this. Like I said earlier, Slim's victory helped the British. And it helped the British to leave, enable British to leave India with dignity. The others were all other colonial powers left India beaten. These people went with some sense of dignity with a military parade and all that. Okay, that's the historical connect. What are the Indian interests? Or ethnicity? I mean, there's no doubt about it. We have a connectivity issue. This is the third channel of communication with the Northeast. The first is through the Siliguri corridor. Second, which I'll show you a little later, through Bangladesh. And third is through the Bay of Bengal. Again, I'll show you. Then we have this trilateral highway, which is coming up as part of the Lukis policy. And then the Chinese activity and threat to destabilize Northeast and the physical threat from the old Lido Road. That the China-Myanmar economic corridor if it is developed and the Chinese army is there, PLA is there to protect that corridor, anytime they can turn east and, you know, invaders from that side. And then the ASEAN connectivity is through Myanmar. Then you have the things like Sagar and BIMSTEC, which are Myanmar is common to that. And of course, like I said, the Indo-Pacific and COT strategy is at risk. That's a major one, which should make us think very seriously. Now, when you look at this, like I said, any instability in Myanmar will affect these four states. And we'll have a refugee crisis, which we are already having. And we have insurgent bases in Myanmar. I mean, our insurgents go in Myanmar and sit down. Tomorrow, today, they'll say, our insurgents are sitting in your areas. So there is a very delicate issue which will happen, especially in Nagaland and Manipur, right? And then, of course, the Nagas, Mars, Mizos, Chins resides on both sides of the border, both sides. The Nagalim or the Greater Nagaland, which the Naga rebels claim, half of it is in Myanmar and half of it is here. The Kaplang faction of the NSNIM was Myanmar-oriented. That fellow Kaplang was born in Myanmar. He's a Myanmarese Naga. So we have issues. We have a lot of connectivity. We have a lot of interest in these northeastern states. And we've had an on-off relationship with Myanmar, but off late the relationship has been very good. Right? In fact, our Chief of Army Staff here, Chief of Army Staff and the Secretary MEA visited Myanmar recently to have a talk with them. And so we need to have balance and we need to look at it real politic. Aung San Suu Kyi, for all the democracy, has not been good to us in the recent past, though she is a product of the Delhi University. So it's a mosaic. It's a shifting mosaic. We have to be clear about that. Like this, I said, this is the third route from Howrah, a sea route, just about 500 odd kilometers. You hit the Kaladon multimodal port and you go up to Mizoram and then the northeast gets connected. Should the Siliguri corridor go into problem, this is there. This is almost ready. It's in the final stages. And this is a effort by us of over a decade. For the past one decade, we've been trying to operationalize it. For one reason or other, it's not been happening. Now it's in the final stages. If Myanmar goes bonkers, we are in trouble. Or Northeast, I won't say trouble, we've closed one channel, which we've struggled so long to hold. Right. And then this trilateral highway, which, you know, starts all the way, this blue line, goes through Myanmar and goes through right up to Thailand. And the idea is that there's a talk also of extending this through Vietnam to touch Japan so that it cuts across the BRI. Right. So you.
But even here, General Ravishankar, even here, this is going to cut CMEC.
Yes, that's the whole idea. CMEC is part of the BRI anyway.
So how are they going to have these two major highways? Who is going to say, I'll be over you, assuming that there is no connection?
That's the thing. See, that's the whole story. That's the whole game which is going to go on. But then, you know, Myanmar has agreed to this. This trilateral highway has been in the offing for quite some time. This will go through because it's just a road. And let people, this thing, we've almost taken it right up to Moray already. Okay. Now, what is India's take? India is in a state of strategic ambiguity. We are urging for release of political prisoners. We support any attempt to resolve the current situation through ASEAN, whatever you say. We have also condemned use of any violence. We are like a cat on the wall right now. But we are dealing with the Tatmadaw. And we believe rule of law should prevail, which it will not. And we stand for restoration of democracy in Myanmar. All this. And we are dealing with the refugees as per law and humanitarian considerations. We are taking them in. Initially, though, there was some dissonance on this. But now I think we are very clear on this. Right. What is our future stance? You need to be proactive. I mean, there's no point in sitting on the sidelines and watching. Yeah, you can be a cat on the wall to jump whichever side you want to go, but you need to be proactive. Okay. You need to keep China on the sidelines and secure the Northeast. Right. It is not just losing Myanmar. The moment China comes and sits there, your northeast is threatened, which is worst, which is the worst problem for us. Right. Having said this, India is actually in the best position to bring about reconciliation. People trust us. We have good equation with Atmadav and fairly good equation with the democracy. So we need to leverage this. Like I said, yeah, we're okay. And we need to use ASEAN and Quad as platforms. We need to shift from strategic ambiguity and we need to go into a thing where we promote all-round acceptability. When you want to do it is a different question. Right? But you have to do it. There's no question of not doing it. That's the point I'm trying to make. If you say, no, I'll not do anything, I'll let, you know, think that it will go out of our hand. You have to jockey accordingly, patiently, with purpose, and move at the right time. Let's not keep sitting on the sidelines, because this crisis is an opportunity. As much as it's a crisis, every crisis, like they say, is an opportunity. Like Churchill once said, never waste a crisis. So we shouldn't waste this crisis. And we need to be bold. We need to be strategically confident. The good thing is, with the Eastern Ladakh situation, India has gained a lot of strategic confidence. And we should use that strategic confidence to handle this. Everything rubs off, right? In any case, you're not right now troubled on the western border. Pakistan is degenerating and it's happening and it's not an imminent threat to us. Whereas this is the unseen threat which is going to hit us on the backside. It's a backhand hit. So we have to think. And this is where I'll end my presentation. Jai Hind, and now, sir, we can discuss.
A few questions jump out. First one, if my memory serves me correctly, Aung San was assassinated, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was.
Okay. He was. So that is why somebody else ascended the throne when they became independent.
Yeah. I agree with you.
And the second thing was, sir, when I listen to this presentation, you know, Myanmar looks very similar to Pakistan in that it too appears to be an army with a country. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, it is. It was like that for the best part of its existence. Things were changing. Things were changing because the army saw that unlike Pakistan, Pakistan was outgoing and positioned itself as a frontline state. Myanmar was isolated, right, with the army in control. But like I said, 2010-11, they started coming out of the equation. And they started saying, look, we can't continue like this. So we have so much with us. So let's start normalizing life. And Thein Sein did a lot to get things going. So, but fundamentally, you're right. It's an army with a country.
Now, Aung San Suu Kyi was not allowed to become the prime minister on a technicality, if I remember correct, sir.
At this point of time, it was basically for vote rigging and election rigging. That's about all.
No, not even this election. I'm talking about the previous term when she was there.
Yeah. Look, they just chose some kind of a thing. I mean, to keep her out of power.
Just they want some ruse or the other to keep
some
her out of
power. Some ruse or the other to keep her out of power. That's irrelevant.
So the most immediate challenge I see for India right now is the Rohingya crisis, and is the
Atmadav.
The army. Are they willing to, you know, say, okay, look, this is not, they are straying into other countries. We need to say, get them back to our land. I mean, that's where normalcy should start, isn't it?
Oh, no. Today Rohingya is not the issue. It is the other refugees, the political refugees. The main problem is today between the NLD and the Atmadav, right? Look, Atmadav will not accept Rohingyas back because they are the ones who throw them out. So that's not this. Rohingya crisis, if you put Rohingya crisis into the fray today, the situation will even deteriorate further. The first thing is to get a reconciliation between these two lot. Of course, there are reports that they've released some prisoners. They're doing something, but we don't know what it is. And if the army chief Min Ho Leung, he is going to attend a meet of the ASEAN, and that's the first meet he's going to attend outside the country. Let us see how things happen, because Rohingyas don't have a great future in this. They're the second problem.
I meant for India, Rohingyas is one of the bigger problems right now.
Right now, the problem is the refugees who are coming into Manipur and into Nagaland.
Oh, you mean the political refugees? I see.
Not political, even normal. Because if there's chaos, who will stay there? Mm. See, the Rohingya problem really is not our... There are not many Rohingyas with us. They're all mostly in Bangladesh. Mm. Right? They've gone into the Chittagong Hills Tract and that belt. Rohingya problem for us is a little farther away than the actual refugees who come here. And in these refugees, there are also political refugees. We are setting up political refugee camps. There's a humanitarian crisis developing there, which is the more important thing for us today. And like I said, the more important thing for us is not only this, we can handle the refugee crisis and all that. Future of Myanmar is the bigger issue for us.
Mm-hmm. Well, this was a wonderful look at our neighbor. I don't think anybody has done to this depth. I could be wrong, of course. But General Ravi Shankar, thank you very much for taking the time and patience to map out the entire history of Myanmar, India's relationship with Myanmar. In fact, it's a very special relationship. And also the role of India and Indian Army in the Second World War and perhaps even the First World War. I seem to remember a quote where a British general is famously supposed to have said, "We will fight the Germans to the last Indian."
Yeah, Japanese.
Japanese
to the last Indian. Yes, yeah. Yeah, I agree with you. Like I said, tremendous. I learned a whole lot of things from reading those books about Burma, the Burma campaign. It was a great teaching for us when we were youngsters. A lot of military history is there. A lot of our doctrines flow from that. Right. So there's a connect. And like I said, there's an ethnic connect. All the Chettis and Naidus of Chennai used to be timber merchants who had tremendous links with Burma.
Yes. Maybe sometime in the future, you and I can talk about Dvibhashis.
Yeah.
Dvibhashi, two-language. Yeah,
two-language people.
People.
In fact, today, if there are any Dvibhashis, they are in Andaman Nicobar. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how many people know, the Andaman Nicobar Islands is equidistant from Calcutta and Chennai. Hmm. And these are the two places from where flights go to Andaman Nicobar, Port Blair. And it's very interesting to note that the two languages which are dominant there are Bengali and Tamil. Of course, as a result, Hindi has come up.
Yes. Fascinating. Where all the British took India along with them.
Yeah.
If you go and it's diminishing, but you can still see it. In cities like Kuala Lumpur, you will see perfect Tamil-speaking Sardars.
Correct. I agree with you.
Yeah, and there's a history behind that also.
Yeah.
Amazing stuff. Well, yeah, thank you very much, General Ravi Shankar. And we'll be back again, viewers, with more such interesting insights into all our neighbors and what everyone is up to and what are India's concerns and how India is dealing with them. Namaskar.
Thank you and namaskar.